but a lot that we do disable here. This is a Wolf Ranch Road looking southbound. These are homes, we're probably 200 yards away. These homes are all along a road called Courtney Drive, all fully involved. And this is when I realized that we're absolutely big, big trouble. This is going to be a firestorm. This entire area was because the winds were swirling around. Sometimes you can see clear pictures, and then sometimes things look a little darker because the wind was blowing towards us, and then it's blowing away from us. I did not want to move from this location for a little while until I felt comfortable enough to do so. I didn't want to become a fire victim myself, but I wanted to get the footage that we needed to show.
That was a pretty eerie sound.
Saving lives. I didn't know anything until I got around. So I was having a chief, besides the other things, this is a hot shot from Redding, California. These guys were amazing. They brought after the fire. They chased this fire down like they were when like the fire afraid of them. And they were absolutely superb wildland firefighters. They did a great job of making sure that this fire was not spread the way through. And they were very thorough and very fast.
But it's stucco, it's got a Class A roofing on it.
As we came around the corner, this took my breath away. It's Ashton Park Place in Charing Court.
They're doing a good job of guarding, making sure that it doesn't cross the line. They are drawing the line here.
This is the other side of this where my taping is, Ashton Park. And it looked like the entire neighborhood was going up. And
we get
driving back down, driving north, you can see our fire trucks positioned all along the road there. What they were doing was deciding they were going to make a stand here. And they did just that. They made a stand here and did not allow that fire to get across into the other neighborhood where there were hundreds of homes that would have been destroyed had they not been there. This is up off of Wilson Road and then a street called Darien Way. This single engine company right here kept the fire from spreading and saved the entire street. It was a cul-de-sac, so it was kind of a dead end. This is another scene that just took off.
Okay, I was going to ask for maybe a structure engine in the alley. Make sure we keep this one.
What do you know? I mean, the house in the blood had the fire.
The fire right in front of the one that's burning in the ground.
Yeah.
They had the never-ending, never-ending supply of water to keep his neighbors from burning in the ground.
Yeah. Hang in there.
Yeah.
We're along.
They did a good job because it was standing the next day. So they did their job, but they stood their ground. Impressive crew. I don't know who they were. I think they were federal. And as we come around the corner here, you can see the sparks flying all over the place. It was raining fire down on us. This is why, so many roofs caught on fire. Again, right back behind them was Huffman Court, and so I went and stopped the vehicle. I looked in between a couple of houses just to check and see how they were doing. And they were still making it. They were still eating smoke and fire. They were enduring tremendous amounts of heat, but they saved this neighborhood.
Because it only stayed into this cul-de-sac on one hole. The exposure to the south of it was spared. And so the rest of the block was spared.
This is Wilson Road, and it's east of Flying W Ranch Road, someplace that we did not want fire to be, but we had to do what we had to do, and that was to defend these structures. This is a crew that's on Flying W Ranch Road, very close to Champagne Drive. the fire over here by Majestic Drive was intense and probably wiped out about 45 homes. But these guys took their stand and then they saved everything south of there, and it was a very valiant effort on their part. This is again Flying Derby Ranch Road. This is down by Ashton Place. And Manitou Springs Fire Department is trying to protect a structure on the backside of the house. And on the opposite side of the house is Denver Fire Department. And they're putting up another master street. This is still Manitou right here. And now this is the opposite side. This is Denver Fire Department, Ashton Fire Place. That one structure is pretty well gone, but they were bending everything north, and this house did survive, as well as the other houses that were north of that. So those two departments did a great job of getting a stop right there. This is Denver Fire Department again. They have five crews down here during the place, and they're putting up a water curtain. They're defending this home right here on the left, and this other home is pretty much gone. This home is generating a lot of sparks.
Here again, across up here, and landed on that roof right there, and it's starting on fire. Alright, we're here at the house two doors down from where Denver FD is. Clint found a hose, a garden hose. We're trying to put this roof fire out. This will be the first fire, and he did it. It's the first fire he's ever put out as a CSFD firefighter. Not yet sworn in, but he did it. Nice job, Clint. Nice job. We got some stuff back up here, some embers and glows. He's going to take care of it. Neighbors were smart enough to leave a garden hose out here, and I believe that might have saved their home. I know I'm broadcasting in the dark here, but I'm just going to narrow right here. Clint did it with a garden hose. So
he got it.
He got it.
Nice.
Small victories is what they got out of that fire, that's for sure, on the end of it. I want to give you some facts about the Waldo Canyon fire. 346 homes, 18,247 acres were burned, two fatalities, six injuries, and pretty much 32,000 residents of Colorado Springs were evacuated. For those who don't remember, that was in 2012. That video was filmed by a good friend of mine, Steve Schroeper, who is the videographer for Colorado Springs Fire, and he wanted to give a perspective of behind the scenes for firefighters. And I just think that's a great video to start this tonight. We've done other talks with his video, and a lot of questions come out of that. Some neighborhoods were saved because of mitigation. Some were saved because of the construction types of those buildings. And it went from neighborhood to neighborhood as you saw the embers flying everywhere. In a wildland fire, the wind will take those embers. And at Waldo Canyon, it took them a half mile to a quarter mile away from the base of the fire. So wildfires can happen at any time. We're preparing for the next ones to happen. North Fork Fire. I think the chief is going to give a lot of examples of wildfires, and then we've got some great guests tonight. I'd like you to look at your brochure. The first one is going to be Fire Chief Mike Weegee, and then we're going to have Sheriff Rick Albers from Clear Creek. Jefferson County Sheriff's Department is Dan Gard, he's a division chief. And then Travis Griffin from the Colorado Division of Fire Prevention and Control. We'll finish up with Fire Marshal Frank Dearborn, he's here. And he's going to introduce John Chapman, who does the community wildfire protection plans and the implementation plans for us. So, first things first, I want to go over building safety and facilities, exits. We talked about those down here, back there, kind of like the plane. Facilities are in the hallway, the bathrooms are in the hallway. After the forum's over, I'll go over those. We've got some presenters in the back room there. That's on the second page on the inside. Colorado State Forest Service information, Mountain Metro Area Realtors, Clear Creek OEM and Jefferson County OEM. There's information from both of them. If you don't get information from that room tonight, all of this stuff will be on our webpage, so you can pull it up. We're videotaping it, so if you miss something, you can go to our webpage, EFR411.com. I put that on the front, the middle, and the back of this brochure. EFR Communication Center has a display also. FEMA, AmeriGas information, State Farm Insurance, Evergreen Fire Protection District, Fire Prevention, we'll have a table back there. And then there's HEAT and EAPL, that's the Large Animal and Small Animal Protection Links. They've got information back there as well. So, without further ado, Fire Chief Mike Weegee, he's going to start us off. Keep the mic close to your mouth.
Good evening, thanks for joining us here tonight. We really wanted tonight to be more about prevention. This, without what we've had in the last 2 years and how the outlook is for this year, this is the time we need everybody working on their mitigation, working on their properties, getting together as neighborhoods and working on mitigating so we can, you're really helping us attack those fires and helping us protect lives and property. The reality is when we go in to triage an area, we take a quick look at it. If we can't do something in 20 minutes to try and protect that house, we're gonna move on to the next one. So you'll see videos, sometimes you'll see red flags on people's mailboxes at the beginnings of their driveways or in the trees. That's signaling to other firefighters that these houses have been checked, but they can't be saved if the fire comes through here. So we need your help to get the work done, find ways to get it done, get your neighborhoods together. We're going to have a presenter here tonight that's going to talk about ways to do that. The fire department's been funding a program. It was really started in Clear Creek County, and it rolled over into the Evergreen Fire Protection District, so we want to keep it going. I'll let John Chapman talk about that later, but we're funding that so people have tools to get these groups together and get the mitigation done. A quick status of the Evergreen Fire Protection District. We've got about 80 firefighters right now, which is really good. They're all volunteers. They all live right here in the district. The outlook is for this spring and summer is as it is right now. It's expected to be an average to below average fire season. That doesn't mean we don't get fires. We're still going to get the lightning strikes. Our self-facing exposures are still going to see fires burning. Throughout the state, an average year brings about 3,600 fires yet. So last year, that burned about 39 square miles. So we're still going to see our fires. Our goal is to jump on them fast, to get them out before they spread. But we need your help for us to accomplish that. Evergreen and conifer nationwide still remain very high on the list for extreme wildfire behavior communities and very high in the dollar amount of loss potential. So we're a spotlight. I just want to thank everybody for joining us tonight. There's materials out in the training rooms, and I'll hand it over to our other speakers. Just remember, it's not a matter of when we're, it's not a matter of if we're going to get a wildfire, it's a matter of when, and it's going to happen in Evergreen. We just need to prepare, and I wanted tonight to be about prevention and preparedness. So thanks for joining us.
Good evening, Sheriff Rick Albers, Clear Creek County, just over that way. I want to thank you for having me here tonight. It's a pleasure to be here. I agree with Chief Weegee, let's hope we have a slow and minimal fire season. I hate fire. That video there, the house burning down, just makes you want to cry. Like Chief Weegee said, in Clear Creek County, we got a grant to see WPIP. With the help of John and a whole bunch of work for $212,000 for the Elko Hills subdivision. We're still in the process of getting that worked out. That's mitigation work around some of the roads up there and the houses. So that's going to help Evergreen Fire out a lot. One thing I want to really pound in is, you know, I got like 12 patrol officers in Evergreen County. That's 24 eyes. I have 9,000 citizens out there. That's 18,000 eyes. If you see smoke, call us. I really go put a campfire around or something like that to find out somebody's having an illegal burn, because all burns should have permits, either through Evergreen or the Clear Creek Fire Authority. But call us, please. We'd rather get them when they're small than when they get big and out of control. There's been great cooperation between the Evergreen Fire and Clear Creek Fire Authority. They always work as a team because they kind of overlap on I guess, in the west end of Jefferson County and the east end of Clear Creek County. They work together all the time, and I'm really proud to be part of that. One thing I do want to iterate here is sign up for Code Red. It's not only for wildland fire, but it's for we have a bad guy in the area or something like this also. We do a Code Red call out to that neighborhood. So if you're not signed up for Code Red, I'm not sure if somebody's gonna go over that later or not, but it's on the Clear Creek County website for Clear Creek County under the Sheriff's Office, and there's a big Code Red button on the front of the page there. Excuse me. So make sure you sign up for that. Get your phone numbers in there. That way, if there is an issue or something like that, you notified. And one of my friends, the Evergreen Fire Department, Doug, who's in the back there, he told me once that our fire season is January 1 to December 31st. And in Clear Creek County, and I'm pretty sure Jefferson County, it's a fact. We've had fires in November, January, so don't let your guard down, because we could have a slow winter month and fires start pretty darn easy up here. We fought one on Floyd Hill, I think 3 or 4 years ago, where it was going through the weeds and there was still snow on the bottom of those weeds. So please make sure you give us a call. Other than that, I really don't have anything. If you have any questions or anything like that, or Fort Clear Creek County, you reference wildland fires, anything at all, give me a call. My door's always open. Thank you.
Dan Gard from Jefferson County Sheriff's Office. Thanks for having us here. If I'd known Travis Griffin was going to be here, I would have had him present this, because this would, he knows more about it than I'll ever know. He used to work for the Sheriff's Office, and the state stole him away, and we still haven't filled your job. I want to tell you that you're lucky that you've got some great fire protection people up here. We enjoy working with the fire departments up in the Round area. They do great work, and they work hard to prepare for whatever might come up. And it's all about preparedness. You know, the sheriff's office is constantly training and trying to buy new equipment to do whatever we can for, to respond to fires. But our role is very small. You know, our role is typically just evacuations. But what you don't see behind the scenes, there's a lot more going on at the sheriff's office. So I wanted to talk about that for just a minute. What we do during the high fire season, red flag days, the high wind warning days, where there's a high risk of fire, is bring in additional deputies that can help locate the fires. Really, that's the key to fighting these things, is locating the fire and getting the fire resources directed into it. You'd be surprised how many times we get a call and somebody says, there's a fire on the south of my house, I can see smoke, but they can't tell us where it is. So it's really, really critical for deputies to get a quick response to that so that we can tell the fire department when they're in route, here's where we've located. And one way we do that is we've trained the deputies to use, in map reading and to use compasses in triangulating fires. It sounds like a simple thing, but it's not so easy to locate a fire using a compass and a map. And typically it takes three people in the best situation to locate there. They're carrying special equipment. Once in a while, we lead the fire department to a fire, and deputies are carrying some basic things like shovels and other basic fire tools in the trunk, where they may get out and attack that fire and tell fire department to get there. We've actually had some luck. Up in Deer Creek Canyon a couple years ago, we got the fire out before the fire department got there. That wasn't evergreen, and it wasn't because they were slow. It was just because we got three deputies in there very quickly, and they ran over to a neighbor's shed and grabbed some shovels and rakes and put that thing down. So they'll do whatever they have to do. In addition to trying to locate these fires by maps and compass, we've got some great resources from the state. What are those planes called, Travis?
Multi-mission aircraft.
They've got infrared equipment, and they can fly over the fire, give us a great GPS location, something in the backcountry that's difficult to get to, and we can get resources into it immediately. We've got three helicopter companies on contract this year to respond to fires, and should have be able to have those resources in quickly to deal with. One of our first duties will be meet up with the fire personnel on scene to have a unified command so that we can work together and make decisions on what needs to be evacuated, what areas they're going to attack, and then decide on those code red notifications to the community. That's really important. Sheriff Alders mentioned signing up for it. Make sure you sign up for your cell phones also. Most people put in their home phone if they still have home phones. But put in your cell phone so you get that notification wherever you are and find out what's going on in your neighborhood. Once we liaison with the sheriff, the fire management officer, which was Travis, will come up there and start dealing with additional resources and calling in things. And he is our liaison with fire because the FMO, the fire management officer from the sheriff's office, talks that way. We're cops. No matter what we find in all of our lives, but we're too scared to even go into burning buildings and deal with that. So we become cops. Some of our jobs are evacuations, road closures, school closures, and other resources, bringing them in. I mentioned the helicopters. State also has some resources with single engine attack crafts, airplanes that come in and deal with these things. And what you don't see is our emergency operations center. When something big is going on, a large fire, another emergency, we ramp that thing up. And I tried to get a photo of it. I couldn't find anybody that had one today when I was dealing with this. But we may have representatives from the school, the road and bridge, public health, search and rescue, EMS, the hospitals, utilities, hazardous materials, all those different groups in our emergency operations center. ramped up to deal with whatever emergency we have going on. And you know, it's funny how quickly a fire can exhaust the resources of your fire department. We had a fire last year down in the Hogback. It was about 8 hours, and West Metro Fire, who is a very large fire department, their resources were exhausted in about 8 hours. And we had to call in additional resources to deal with this. And that's when our incident management team, which is a group of volunteers sponsored by the sheriff's office, comes in. We've got about 120 volunteers that will come in and take over a situation like that. And it's a type 3 incident management team. And that their whole job is dealing with a large disaster. And then they have, once that group comes in to deal with that, they have additional resources through the state, additional funds they can give, and basically take over from fire to assist them. Well, we don't actually really take over with that. Fire's always in there helping advise on these things because they're your representatives in the community. And we, Chief, do we have anybody from Evergreen Fire on that IMT?
Sure, we do.
People from a lot of different agencies, several people from the Sheriff's Office on here. We've got a lot of experience from the metro area here that comes in to deal with those issues. Prevention activities, I talked about preparation. Something you may not know is we have a fuels crew that works under contract to different places like Denver Mountain Parks, going in doing fuels, cutting down trees, getting rid of brush and other things that may have a potential for being fire fuels. To do that, we have some great equipment that the county has provided to us. Skid steer with a grabber and mulcher on it. We have a lawn skidder that can actually pick up some pretty large trees. A heavy duty chipper that will handle 18-inch trees whole. That's a big chipper. And a Type 6 wildland engine that we'll send out some of our resources, some fuels for people maybe on that. Or we have a staff for people from the fire departments in the metro area. Those are just some of the things. You wouldn't think law enforcement gets involved much with fires, and we're always in a support role. Those are the important guys. That's the people that's trained for it. The fire department does great work, and like I said, you got great fire departments up here to deal with these issues, and we'd love to support them because they're good people. If you haven't been back in the classroom, I've got a new emergency preparedness guide that talks about all sorts of different types of disasters and what you can do. And we have the Ready, Set, Go pamphlet. It's important to know what those levels of preparedness are. Ready is level 1 if you get a notification on your phone. Level 1 is get ready. We may be asking you to leave. We don't know what your situation is in every case. If you feel you need to get out, you've only have a level 1 notification, go ahead and get out. Surprisingly, our phones are swamped with these kind of situations. It could be a small fire, but we have hundreds of calls on it. Same thing for every fire. It can overwhelm your resources to answer phones and get information out. And sometimes we're behind the curve on what the fire is actually doing until we get resources on scene. So even if we may be at a level 1 or level 2, which is get set to leave, don't wait if you think that fire is too close. And then level 3 is get out immediately, don't wait for anything. You should have your vehicle packed up and ready to go to that point. We've been lucky the last couple of years, we haven't had much to deal with, and we hope it continues this year with the long moisture we've got. But it only puts it off for a period of time. Sooner or later, that heat's going to show up and brings a long way to dry stuff out. And that's when we'll be working with Evergreen Fire, with Travis and the state. And we'll try and do our best for you. That's all we promise. Use the resources we have and do the best that we can. So thanks for having us here.
cheat sheet would be up a little bit. I'm prepared with a PowerPoint presentation. I'm going to shoot from the hip for you guys. Do my best here. My name is Travis Griffin. I work for Colorado State Division of Fire Prevention and Control. And to give you a quick background on myself, I've been in the Front Range area most of my life, Fort Collins days, and spent a lot of time doing wildland fire suppression in the state of Wyoming. Came back, worked for Colorado State Forest Service as a forester, doing grants, wildland fire suppression, and then moved over to the Sheriff's Office for a little while as a fire management officer, and just recently came over since January, working with the state, and I got to know a lot of the emergency services personnel and Jeffco pretty well, and all across the state, and really the region and nationally. It's a pretty tight community with wildfire. What I've come to realize here locally is that the structured fire departments, the sheriff's office, we all do our best to work together and really assist. You know, you see all these fancy fire trucks and nice resources that are out here that are, it's all your guys' taxpayer, my taxpayer dollars that go towards all this preparedness and prevention resources that we can try to provide you guys a lot of assistance on the front end before fire hits. And what I was asked to talk about today was some of the actual response resources that the state can bring to the table. And but before I get into those resources, I just want to echo everything that Evergreen and Sheriff Rick Alvarez and Chief Gar has said that it's a monumental effort here locally on the Front Range with the amount of fires that we typically get, and then those instances where, human caused ignitions on those times of year where the wind really blowing, hot temperatures, dry humidities, and sustained winds can really increase a small fire to get out of hand and cause an incredible amount of damage and destruction to your guys' properties, to your livelihoods, to just everything that you care so much about living up here. It's a pretty substantial risk, honestly, and doing everything in your power to assist us when the bell rings and we're evacuating you, and so we can try to get a handle on the incident, is just it's a big community effort. It's not just the responders. It's so much to be relying on you guys to have good networks amongst yourselves, to call each other, to have rendezvous points, and being able to move each other's friends and family and dogs and pets quickly and get out of harm's way. And so that really gets into, once that's going on and you guys allow us to get in and do good work, and you guys have done that mitigation work around your homes, that's when all of that fire suppression apparatus and law enforcement and animal evacuation resources are there to do effective response. And so Chief Guard mentioned there's two what's called multi-mission aircraft. And they're two fixed-wing aircraft, and they're Pilatus, if there's any pilots in the room. But they're pretty capable fixed-wing turbine-powered jet aircraft. And they're down in Centennial at the hangar, and they have technology on there. It's like this RJD2 looking ball that drops out of the aircraft, can zoom in and find heat signatures and provide incredible intelligence to the ground resources, to the emergency operations center, of exactly where that fire might be. And because of the risk you guys have here locally, 9 times out of 10, there's other fires going on in more remote areas of the state or even the country. That resource will be available and be on scene. provided that intelligence. And then it also does some mapping so we can find out what size it is and generally where it's going. And there's some really good qualified folks up there running the radios and running that software to provide that intelligence. So on top of that aircraft, we also have what's called single engine air tankers. And it's basically your traditional like crop dusters. And they have the ability to reload with slurry or water at Jeffco Airport or a number of other reload bases. They're called tanker bases all across the state, across the country. And 800 gallons, they can split their load into multiple drops. The Bluebell Fire, we utilized them back in 2013. A number of historical fires in one front range. They've been a pretty rapid response. We have one on contract already. The other one comes on a little bit later. And they're around during that traditional fire season of you know, May to October when we get those natural ignitions. There are some wind limitations with those, just like our helicopters, which we have on contract. Three helicopters, two of them are the smaller platforms that you would generally ride around in a, like if you took a, you know, a tour of the Grand Canyon, you know, it's something smaller. Whereas our third helicopter is like your traditional Huey, and that's basically straight up a water delivery, cargo delivery aircraft, whereas the other two move personnel and can provide helicopter support personnel to more remote areas. So that's basically our aircraft fleet that we put on contract, and the multi-mission are year-round, and the helicopters and seats are more for our traditional fire season. Other resources that we bring to the table are engines, wildland fire engines. So we type them, usually it's type 6 is small, type 1 is like your structure protection resources, the big ladder trucks are type 1. So we generally, with our wildfire agency, run with type 6s and type 4s, and then we have what's called wildland urban interface engines that are coming online here soon. We're going to be having 5 of those across the state. So we're going to have 5 Type 3 resources, which can get down those tighter driveways and have a lot more water pumping capabilities and have a little bit larger crew. And they have generally more specialized tools and equipment on board than our Type 6 can carry. And so stay tuned for that. My fingers crossed I'm going to be getting one of those here locally. And right now I have a Type 6 and a Type 4 locally in Golden that's available to respond for multiple incidents. And then we also have a number of squads that are able to take on a like a veteran corps crew or other hand crews. So when we really get busy, the state can tap into our veteran corps and staff up multiple 20-man hand crews to assist. And that's in addition to the Department of Corrections has hand crews that are year-round over Buena Vista and Rifle is where they're called SWIFT. Just they're basically inmates that are on very short time, about to be on parole, and anyhow they provide valuable resources. These guys love coming out and fighting fire and working the fire line. They're an invaluable resource. They're kind of like a hotshot crew, but just not quite as qualified or trained. And then of course we have the ability to pull on all of the interagency resources from the feds and the counties and states around the regions nationally to bring in to incident management scene and provide an incredible amount of resources with heavy air tankers, very large air tankers. There's what's called a super tanker, which is a 747. All of those resources are beckoning call through the state, the county, the sheriff's office. We'll get it coming if this situation dictates that. So I can talk all night long. I know that there's some other presenters. I'm getting a hoodie, so I'm around all night. Just so I'm aware, and I generally do this because I've probably seen a lot of you guys at some of these meetings. But who here has lived here since 2002? Okay. Who here has lived here since Buffalo Creek, 1996? Okay. So, who here's properties are 100% mitigated when they do their annual maintenance?
Right.
So those are the people that are, you newbies need to go talk to those folks and find out all the tricks of the trade, because they probably have been there, done that, seen a lot, know a lot of how to kind of formulate those communities and get, you know, some of the best practices and focus on the cutting and how to take care of each other when the temps are high, the RHs are low, the wind's blowing, somebody starts a fire, or some runner cell starts a fire, and those are the folks that really know what's going on. So thanks for you guys' efforts, and keep it up. It's a monumental task. This is not going away. Somebody wiser than me once said that this mitigation thing is like eating an elephant one sitting, one bite at a time. So you can do it. That's pretty much what I have. Come find me, come bug me, do some around.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Dan, can you turn on the lights? I just want to make a quick statement. First of all, we're going to have a fire forum every month because it snows every time we have one of these. So July, August, September, we're going to have a fire forum. And I will just say this, Travis, hopefully we have snowmobiles available to us from the state, perhaps. They have track vehicles. Okay, perfect. The first half of this forum was about resources from the sheriffs and the state. Sheriff Gard told me that he's kind of sad to see Travis leave. And I said, well, he hasn't left us. He's with the state. He has more money now. We can pull from his resources. So I think it's a win-win for us, and we're very happy to have Travis part of our team. And that's what it is with the sheriffs, with Travis, the state, all those resources, we work very well together. So the second part is the fire marshal, Frank Dearborn, and we're gonna talk a little bit about resources that are available locally to you. One of those is the CWPIP, and he's gonna do some introduction to that. So Frank, you wanna come up? Frank Dearborn, our fire marshal.
Good evening, anybody hear me? I know, this is the mic. Good evening. As introduced, I'm the Fire Marshal, Frank Dearborn. I've been here for 18 years, and one of the programs we're in charge of is the CWPIP for the community. I was involved with the county one as well in 2007. We have been given donations as well as we budgeted this year, and we've also been given a donation of $5,000 as of yesterday to continue the CWPIP program for Evergreen Fire. And we have John Chapman, who's been running it for us for the past couple of years, and he's gonna be talking about it, and I'll let him talk. I'll talk afterwards. John, it's yours.
Good evening, everybody. This is a privilege for me to do this. I've been, by way of background, I was
was with the National Park Service for about 36 years. And I've been retired for some years now. And for about 10 years, I've been working with community wildfire protection planning up and down the Front Range. And the past 2 years, primarily in Clear Creek County, and now down here in the Evergreen Fire Protection District. And Chief Leach, you mentioned the fact that there's been some talk about this being an average or maybe below average fire year. But like Travis said, given the right, or if you want to call it, the wrong conditions at the right or wrong time, you can have a fire that affects you and your neighborhood, no matter what may be happening somewhere else. So the whole objective of having you folks come to a meeting like this and think about your own properties is what you can do to help the chief and the fire department out. About 2003, there was a real recognition nationwide that a lot of these wildland urban interface areas were growing very rapidly in terms of housing, residential areas, small communities. And there was a push begun at that time to have these small communities in these areas do community wildfire protection plans to look at what they can do with their properties in order to help keep fires from being as hot as they can be, because fires are burning more often, they're burning hotter. We put out fires for 100 years, there's a lot of growth out there in some of these areas. So the idea was, what can you do with your property so that when, as the chief said, a fire, not if, but when it burns, maybe comes to your area, it burns less hot, lays down better, moves on past your property. So the whole idea of those community wildfire protection plans was to do that. And there's been a lot of them done nationwide. There's probably about almost 200 in the state of Colorado alone right now. And a lot of them have been done on the basis of a fire protection district. And as Frank said, the one for Evergreen was done about 2007. And it breaks the Evergreen Fire Protection District down into about 30 units. And those units have a page in the plan that talks about what their vegetation is like, perhaps how many homes were at least in the unit at the time the plan was written, and what are some of the general recommendations made by the planning team that did that plan for what that unit could do to help itself. The biggest thing that any of these plans will look at is what you can do for defensible space for the homeowner around your own property. And the plan talks about that, but it has some generalized recommendations. And what I've been doing for the protection district is doing implementation plans for these various units, where we take the recommendations made for that unit in the Evergreen plan, and it's a team of you folks. It's your plan. I'm the guy from out of town with a briefcase. I write it, I help you put it together, and Frank comes to some of the meetings. Doug Savage comes to some of the meetings, but the idea being it's going to be put together with the Evergreen Fire Protection Division's advice and blessing in the final analysis. The chief will sign off on it. But which of those priorities in that Evergreen plan makes sense to you to tackle first? And do you have perhaps, in looking back and after you look at things, maybe there's some other things you think aren't in that plan that you think should be done? And that's fine, because it's really an implementation plan for your unit of the Evergreen Fire Protection District. We've done one for North Turkey Creek. Byrne back there was the team leader for North Turkey Creek. We're just finishing up with one for Hiwan Hills. We're looking at one now for the Marshdale area and Evergreen Meadows East. So we're picking up some of these units. We've also done one several years ago for Echo Hills that Rick Oliver has mentioned the fact that we got that plan enabled Echo Hills to get and compete for and get some state grant money to help them do defensible space and work around their area. So when we take the unit and look at those recommendations, it's up to your team, your unit team, to decide which of those makes sense to do and what priority you want to put them in. And then we write and flesh out those priorities so it becomes more of a project statement than just a one-line recommendation. And we can put in maps and other things that are necessary to show what we're really talking about, to try and make sure that when this is done, you, your area, has a plan that then you as your team can go to your neighbors and start helping to educate them, get that plan out there so that they know what's going on And the chief and the fire department in turn have that plan as something they can look at to work with you, as knowing what you and they have finally agreed upon are the most important things for you to deal with within your area. And it could be usually, like I say, homeowner defensible space at the tops, and structural resistance to ignition. But maybe there's some certain roads, and we did this for North Turkey Creek, certain of the roads in the area we identified as being roads that really should be looked at and considered for thinning along the roadway, where the vegetation gets right down to the roadway to make evacuation much, much safer and easier, and also for ingress for the firefighting units. So we recognize those types of things. Also for instance, again, I'll pick on North Turkey Creek, there are four Denver Mountain Park areas in and around that unit. And so the team decided, and that wasn't in the initial Evergreen plan actually, the team decided to recommend that those areas do thinning so that if fire burns in those areas, they're not burning hot right now next to the residential areas that abut them. And so they put that in as a recommendation, and it's been taken to Denver Mountain Parks. It came up and met with the team, and Denver Mountain Parks doesn't have money falling out of their pockets either, but basically they've agreed that that should be done. And so they're gonna try to put it in their work plans. So that's the kind of things that can get done if you do an implementation plan for your unit. And it helps you maybe put together some ideas that now we want to go compete for a grant too and get some money to hire somebody to come in and do some of the things that we as individuals would find it difficult to accomplish. So again, that's how you can get a hold of me. And I've got some handouts which will be up in the other room as we're done. If you'd like to come up and get that and talk to me and talk about perhaps my getting in touch with you and your unit, I'll be glad to do that. We'll help put together some of your neighbors to make a plan, and then we'll go ahead and do this. It'll take some meetings to get it done, and then after that's done, it's up to you, the team, to actually get with your neighbors and carry it out. But folks like Frank and Doug and others are around to help you do that too. That's what they're here for. So that's my my spiel.
Okay, so if you are involved with the community-wide wildfire protection plan, or as a homeowner and wants to get rid of your slash, Jefferson County and Clear Creek County have information. They have their websites and the locations where you can get the drop the slash off. Jefferson County has a person by the name of Brent Roller. He is the one organizing the slash sites throughout Jefferson County. And if an HOA wants to set up a collection in their HOA, you can call that number. To get the sites, slash dates, and sites, go to the JEFCO website there, and they have a listing. So they have all the dates and times where I'll go throughout. We have in our district about five slash collection times. We had a fire station at number 8, which is on Brook Forest Road. We have one over there that we have 2 dates on those. Burn permits. If you're doing a mitigation around your home, you can do burn permits from November to the end of March. We've extended it out to April and this weekend if you have a permit. If you live in Clear Creek, you're required to have a permit from us as well as from the state. We fax it to the state, emails it to you, and it costs nothing. Fortunately, Jefferson County charges $80. Sorry. But the permit starts with us. Fill out our application, that also has all the rules and regulations for it. And you also have to fill out the Jefferson County permit. You bring it down to them, or email it down, fax it down to them, or mail it down to them. And after they get the check, they'll come out there and check the property out within 10 days. But we have the restrictions on our paperwork. That's why you make sure you get a copy of it before you leave our office. This is the Clear Creek website that has information on burn permits. If you're interested in that, they have it there. Jefferson County has their own, has all the information there as well. Do not get caught with burning without a permit. The state gets involved, or Jefferson County gets involved, it can be up to a $10,000 fine, court fees. So please, also too, is the fire department responding, and we could charge you for our response as well. We haven't yet, but please, get a permit. Residential properties. Part of my job is to check on existing driveways to get a building permit or new driveways. On existing homes right now, the width of the driveways need to be at least 10 feet wide. Our trucks rate 6, that's what the code stated when they designed through Jefferson County and Clear Creek. As of 1 January, they went up to 12 feet in Jefferson County because we need the room to move around in our trucks. So the county approved it to go to 12 feet. Gates. Who has a gate in their driveway going to their home or a gated community? We try to get the codes for those and stuff on them to get in there, but a lot of times they change the codes. If you have a person have a heart attack in there, we have the old code. We have time taken. Time is essential, especially in the heart attack victim. So please make sure we have the gate code. There's also that some of the gates for HOAs and stuff, subdivisions, they have what it is called a Knox switch. We have master keys on the fire trucks as well as on the officers that opens up the gate. So either give us the list at the code, or we can you can purchase this switch, install it, we can get in there and do it. But time is essential. You know, people like their privacy and stuff, but when they want us, we got to make sure we have access. Residential driveways covered there. Who has a bridge leading to their home? Good. We had some bridges in Evergreen that we cannot get across. We had one bridge, I walked across it with my foot through. Try to get a fire truck across there. Now it's been fixed. But if you know your bridges and stuff in the area that, you know, that we can't get across, we may not cross them. The chief will not cross that bridge. So please, if you know your bridges and stuff, or your neighbors have on it, make sure they know, can they hold up to a 75,000 pound vehicle so we can get water across there. The 75,000s are tankers, tenders and stuff that are used to bring water across. Wildfire mitigation on your home. Clear Creek has a gentleman by the name of John Lare. There's his number up there. That he does it for free if you do it just in Clear Creek County and you get a billing from it. You'll also go to your home for $75 and point out what needs to be done to be compliant with the state requirements for wildfire mitigation that the Colorado State Forest Service puts out. He's certified in that. That's what the county authorized him to do. And he's qualified to do that for those people there. In Jefferson County, there's 9 lists that'll be on the next slide that are required if you're putting 400 square feet to your home that includes a deck. Jefferson County Planning Zoning requires you to get 1 of the 9 people to come to your house, do a defensible space inspection, sign off on it, and they'll give you your building permit. There's the 9 there. Also, some insurance companies will accept letters from this 9 in Jefferson County for insurance purposes. I'm not going to point out which one's the best ones to do it. That's up to you, cost-wise. Each one has a different cost for it. So they only mark the trees down. They do not remove them. So the second group that you need to get through is to take the trees off the property. Then they'll come back and then check it out for you and then sign off on the paperwork with JEVCO. Or do a letter for your insurance company.
Excuse me, can I ask a question here? Is this for existing or just new builds?
This is for new ones, but if you want to have your home do a mitigation, you can use one of these here.
Okay.
They'll do it for your insurance companies, for yourself as well, if you want to do it, you know, for them to come down there. They're certified, they use the state foresters and stuff that you have. They use the Colorado State Forest Service home, residential home, inspection for mitigation and stuff, forms, and so you can use one of those for yourself if you want to.
Okay.
Okay, where's Doug at? This is our website page right here, and that if you click on this right here, it'll give you wildfire information. All this stuff will go to secondary pages and stuff going through. Follow that information through on there. And it'll give you all the information you need. Check your home with it, links, information that we don't cover here, or that's up in the back room and stuff on them, in the other rooms for it. There's a lot of information there. I have cards over here in the corner. I'll be glad to give them out if you have any questions for it. And we still have the people in the back if you want to go back there and talk to them. So I'll be around if you have any questions afterwards, and I'll turn it over to Doug.
Thank you.
Thanks, Fire Marshal Frank. Before we leave the forum, this is kind of a time for question and answer. If you have some questions while they're here, Sheriff Albers had to leave on a call. He's got some situation going in Clear Creek County. But we do have Dan Gard from Jeffco, and we have Travis, and we have the fire chief and the fire marshal. So I'll open it to question and answers. If you have a question for them, something you didn't get. Yeah?
You put a red flag on my mailbox. I'm not going to be real happy. It's too late to do anything about it, right?
A red flag on your mailbox will be too late. Who'd like to address that, chief?
I understand it. But the soccer game, if you're getting out yellow cards before the fire starts, and people get dizzy and take care of it,
and that's what this is all about. Fire form is do your mitigation now while it's raining out, and when we do have those dry seasons, your property's well mitigated. When we only have so many fire trucks and so many firefighters, there's 12,000 homes in the Evergreen Fire Protection District, so we can't protect them all. So we have to triage and pick the ones that can be saved and leave the ones that can't. So that's why we're stressing. Get out, get the work done, get with your neighbors, mitigate your properties. So we have that ability to try and save that house.
So you provided some information on how to come out and do a proper inspection, right? Like cut down this tree or remove this brush. But who can we contact as far as the vendor to actually even do that for us? Or if
you're
wondering ourselves,
what kind of tools are going to need to do that? Gotcha. Who can you contact to do mitigation on your properties?
Not just the inspection, but literally helping turn out
to. Right. As Frank showed, if you go back to the slide with it, Jeffco, all this information, and there's a lot of information on Frank's slides, but this one right here is going to be on our webpage, as well as Jefferson County's. If you see some of the names up there, the LLCs, there used to be foresters, but they also have a company that does mitigation. So you can contact them to come look at your property, mark the trees, and they can probably give you a quote. There's quite a few forest companies up here in Evergreen as well that aren't on this list. So this is just past foresters that are going to come into your property and inspect it and tell you what trees need to be removed, that type of thing. One of the key factors of this forum is to have insurance companies here. And we have some information in the other room. Your insurance company is really going to drive your mitigation of your property. There are some that will look at your property and say, nope, you will clear 30 feet from your house or we're going to drop you like a rock. And that's happened a lot.
So we see that you didn't actually burn in your home after the insurance company did not. They said we have a but obviously every year we still get things, right? The trees have fallen down from the wind or the winter, and so you're not going to be every year you hire someone to come out and handle your property clearing.
Yeah, you know, if you do a great job of mitigating and you take those ladder fuels off the tree and you can reach, there's no more dead branches as far as you can reach with your hand. All the pine needles are 30 feet or greater away from your property. Every year, that grass is less than 3 to 4 inches off the ground. It is the ladder fuels and the ground fuels, and you're trying to separate those. And as you saw, and I don't know if you were here for the video at the beginning, we had a Waldo Canyon fire video. The embers were flying everywhere. I will just say one of the houses caught fire from the embers that landed on the dog bed on the deck. So anything you have on your deck that may be flammable, think about that as your Ready, Set, Go program. What am I going to remove from my deck? How am I going to mitigate my house to get it ready? Is there any holes from those woodpeckers? Because we've got woodpeckers every once in a while up here that put holes in your roof. Those are avenues for embers to fly into your house. Cover up those holes. The cords of wood underneath your deck. If you've got 5 cords of wood, and we see that as firefighters coming up, that's a house that we're going to leave. We're probably going to your neighbors that we can actually protect. So you got to help us help you. Yes?
I live in a town called Harrigan, but in Mutual Aid, and none of us are living in this.
Sure.
It's not my property.
Right.
And if my insurance company says those are the thing, what am I supposed to do?
Well, you can only do what you can do on your property.
Okay.
And truly, nobody can ask you for any more than that. But this is where John comes in. As a community wildfire protection plan and an implementation plan for a community, getting your neighbors together in the same house, hey, what do we got to do to make our area safe? This is why we have John, this is why we have Frank, this is why we do what we do. We've been talking about this in a wildland forum. So, you can only do what you can on your property. You can't tell your neighbor what to do. By fire code, we can't go and initiate the fire code on a single family residence. We can't tell you your property is dangerous. You can do whatever you want on your property. And that's a good protection, I guess, for the public. Keep the fire department out of my business. But we can go into a commercial property and help them, you know what, this looks unsafe, that type of thing. So truly, those people. Travis wants to say something.
So it's kind of like the Tom Sawyer, you know, where he got everybody to paint his fence for him. So that's pretty much what you guys need to do with all those like absentee landowner neighbors that are only there for like 3 months a year. Their whole entire property is overgrown with a bunch of fuel. So if you guys can take the time to educate yourselves, then when they get there for that 3 months or whatever, they you know, might have deep market checkbooks because they own all this land and they're only there for summer. Whatever the situation might be, then you can be like, oh, hey, we've done all this work on the community side, and we have potentially some grants, you know, available to us. There's a lot of, you know, ways to leverage them to get that work going on your behalf, because you're there 90% of the time. And they're only there 10%. So I don't know. There's ways to try to leverage your neighbors. John, definitely John.
Yeah, one thing that Doug kind of alluded to, and you might find if you work with your units, is some people, when I've gone to some areas, get real concerned when we start doing a plan that somebody's going to force them to cut down grandpa's favorite tree. And literally, I've seen that happen up around Allen's Park when I did one there. As he said, it's your private property. These plans, unless you're doing new construction when you're into the county zoning and building permits, but under the established ones, that's your property. I can't force you to cut it down. The plan doesn't force you to cut it down. What these plans are you getting together as neighbors to look at something that seems to make sense and does make sense, put together your plan, and then start working with your neighbors to begin to show them and have forums like this and others, and maybe just do for a day in your neighborhood, where you begin to show people, look at Joe's house, look what he's done, and they find out, gee, it really isn't all that bad, you got approved, it's about time I did something. And Travis is exactly right. And in the long term, it's like painting a battleship. When you start at the bow and you get to the stern, guess what, you go back to the bow because things don't stop growing.
Any other questions? I hope that answered your question.
Yes.
Frank, do you have a question? No.
Okay, man, you asked about resources, about what to do and stuff. The back of your handout has resources back there from the state, from FireWise. There's also books back there in the other room that tell you step by step what to do in zone one, zone two, what to do around your property and stuff, what trees to cut down, what type of material, what type of plants you can put around your home that are fire resistant and stuff on. So there's information there. Same with our website under Wildfire, FireWise. There's links there to go to pages to get some more information. Okay. Anybody else have any questions? Other questions? No, I have the mic. Okay. I have two things. First thing, I'd like to thank the volunteer firefighters for showing up tonight. There's two wildfire trucks outside. You want to get those afterwards. Talk to them, tell them, you know, they'll tell you what their experience is from the Bluebell fire they had last year. And another plug is for our EMS personnel, they're not here tonight. But on the 19th of May, we have a health and wellness day here. It's during the week from 9 to 3. We're also having a children's blood drive. So if you're interested in donating blood to the Children's Hospital, please look at our website. It'll be up here on the screen. On our website, go to EFR 411, and there'll be information there. So, anybody else have anything? Chief? Anybody else? I thank you for showing up. Please go to the training rooms, and there'll be more material there. There's also coffee and water. Thanks again. Have a good evening now.